In this video, we'll introduce the proof method for proving validity. So here's a passage. We've already learned how to translate passages, arguments in particular, from English into our symbolic notation. If you want to jog your memory, feel free to pause the video and practice translating this into symbolic notation. Put it into standard form, and then translate, identifying the relevant operators in atomic statements. So here we go. If you were to go through this whole exercise, you'd identify the atomic statements here, S, D, and A. You'd put it into standard form, fully translate into the symbolic notation, and then we can set up a truth table to prove that this argument is valid. And why is this argument valid? Because there is no case, no row, in which all of the premises are true, and yet the conclusion is false. Indeed, if we look carefully, there is no row in which all of the premises are true in the first place. So we know that there will never be a case where the premises are all true, and yet the conclusion is false. So this argument is valid. And it makes sense, right? If not, pause the argument and sort of think through it. I think you can make sense of this one. So the goal now is to learn a new way to prove that that argument is valid. So we'll take a quick detour to look at common argument forms. So some forms of argument, in particular valid forms of argument, are really common, and they're so common that we'll give them names. So one looks like this. Now I'm using Greek letters rather than regular old capital letters because I want to be clear that these symbols, these variables, can stand for any statement whatsoever and not just atomic statements. If I wrote if A then B, it looks like I mean this is a conditional with two atomic statements, A and B, and that's not what I mean. I'm talking about a conditional where any statement could be the antecedent and any statement could be the consequent. And what I want to point out is that if we have an argument where one of the premises is a conditional statement and another is the antecedent of that conditional, and the conclusion is the consequent of that conditional, this is a valid argument form. And I say form because any argument that has this form, a conditional, antecedent of conditional, and then conclusion is the consequent of the conditional, any argument with this form will be valid. It doesn't matter what statements phi and psi stand for. You could do a truth table to prove this if you wanted to. Because this is such a special argument form, we give it a name. This is modus ponens, or as we'll abbreviate it, MP. The other common pattern we'll talk about in this video is something like a process of elimination. So say that you have one premise that is a disjunction, and another premise is the negation of one of those disjuncts, and you conclude the other disjunct. This is like saying, either I have a cat or a dog, I don't have a dog, therefore I have a cat. But of course, just like before, since I'm using Greek letters, these could be any statement, so it could be something really complicated, like this. This has the same form. It is a disjunction. One of the disjuncts is negated, and we have inferred the other disjunct. This is also a common argument form, and it is special enough that we should give it a name. Sometimes it's called just process of elimination. Sometimes it's called disjunctive syllogism. Or, as we'll abbreviate it, DS. Okay, now that we have looked at two patterns of reasoning, two argument forms that we know to be valid and we could do truth tables to prove it, instead of doing a truth table every time we see something that has this pattern, we'll just know it's valid. We'll have a rule that says, whenever you see an argument with this pattern, you know it's valid. Or, if you're just given the premises, you are allowed to infer the conclusion, the conditional of the statement, by applying the rule of modus ponens. I know that any time I have a conditional and the antecedent of that conditional, by modus ponens, I can infer the consequent of that conditional. So here's how it'll look when we put it all together to do a proof that an argument is valid. So let's take our argument here. Let's prove this using the new tools we've just developed. And remember, we've got modus ponens, which says if you have a conditional and you have the antecedent of a conditional, you can infer the consequent. And we also have disjunctive syllogism, which says that if you have a disjunction and you have the negation of one disjunct, and now note, importantly, it could be either. Maybe we have the negation of not Q. Then you can infer the other disjunct. So now you'll be given an argument. It won't quite look like this. You'll be given premises, and instead of putting the conclusion on the bottom like we do when it's in standard form, we'll move it up here with the three dots, and we'll say, this is the conclusion, and our job is to prove, using rules that we know to embody valid inferences, that A follows from the premises. And it'll look like this. From the premises, I know that since I have a disjunction and the negation of one disjunct, I can infer that other disjunct. So I'll put C on a line, and I'll cite the two lines I'm looking at, lines 1 and 3, and the rule I'm using, disjunctive syllogism. And then on the next line, I will use the fact that I have a conditional on line 2, and I have the antecedent of that conditional on line 4, and the rule of modus ponens, and I will infer the consequent of that conditional, and by infer I mean I'm going to put it on a line, like this, and I'm going to justify my doing that by citing the two lines I was looking at, 2 and 4, and the rule that I used, modus ponens. And now I have shown that I can infer A from premises, which for the sake of argument we assume to be true, and if they're true, we know that C is true by disjunctive syllogism, and if all that's true, we know that A must also be true by modus ponens. So that's the big idea with the proof method.